So here with Lucy Marks, the artist, painter, and also you're going to be exhibiting artwork, aren't you, at Petworth Help? We're going to talk about that a bit later on. First of all, we're going to talk a bit about your career. Okay. Lucy, I know you started off as a counsellor, so tell us a bit about how you became to be a painter that's now going to be... exhibiting at Petworth House. It's quite a big achievement.
Yeah, so I suppose my art career has been a bit varied and how I've ended up where I am. I grew up in an artistic family. My mum was an artist, and so I grew up around paint, which is a bit like an apprenticeship, really. So, I was used to her exhibiting a lot. And then, I grew up in the Brighton area, moved away, started to train as a counsellor. My actual day job for 20 years was really a counsellor. And I kind of wanted to kind of help people, I suppose, help themselves. So it was a long time working as a counsellor. And alongside that, I always painted. And over the years, what happened was my painting became more and more successful. And I went from being a full-time counsellor to a part-time counsellor. Then I went off and did my MA at Brighton University in Fine Art. And now I'm a full-time painter. And so it's been a progression, really, and I feel very fortunate that I can fulfil a dream of painting all the time.
Because it's a dream that a lot of people want to achieve, isn't it? They want to be a kind of a full-time painter. You've managed to do it, though. That's a lot of hard work. I know you did, like, 5 hours painting even when you were a counsellor.
Yeah.
So that's...
I think you have to treat it as a job. You know, if you want to be serious about it, you have to look at it as a job. And so I'm a bit of an early bird. I'm usually in my studio, which is in my house, for 7 o'clock in the morning. And I paint all the way to late lunch, mid-afternoon, most days, if I'm not out with my pochard. So I have a little pochard, which is like a portable easel. And I'll go out into the countryside and I'll paint outside for a whole day as well. And I'll do little oils or watercolours, bring them back, and they're either standalone works in themselves, or I actually work from them for much bigger works in the studio. So I think if you're going to take it on as a career, you have to kind of really think about it quite seriously. And I have a little saying, it's all about miles on the brush. The more you do, the better you get, and the more ingrained you get at it. And it doesn't just happen.
And it's landscapes, isn't it, a lot of your work? Why landscapes?
Yeah. Well, I'm a contemporary landscape painter. You're right there, Mark. And I think, for me, I'm very drawn to nature. I think we're incredibly fortunate to live between the sea and the downs, and both are huge sources of inspiration for me. And I love to see the joy in nature, and my aim is for people to have the joy from my paintings and a joy and a connection back to nature. And if they get that from my work, then I feel I've achieved the job.
Yeah, exactly. And so what kind of paintings, what kind of areas do you kind of focus on then? Do you have certain topics?
Yeah, so during lockdown, the very, very first lockdown, I had been going out sketching in the landscape. And what I'd been doing is I'd been working on 5 National Trust sites all in our area, like Cissbury Ring, Ditchling Beacon. And I was working on those as sketches. Then when lockdown came, I worked each of those areas up into oils and watercolours and put a whole... exhibition online about them. And so for me, I like to pick an area and a theme and really work through it, sketch it, paint it, go out and walk in it and then paint it, and then bring them back to the studio and paint some more. So I suppose I stick to different areas. They tend to be around here because this is where I live. But, you know, I have excursions sometimes down to Cornwall and things, so yes.
Yeah. What about the coastline? Have you... painted a Sussex coastline?
I have, and yeah. I did, in my Quiet Beauty and Space exhibition, I did Berlin Gap, where, with all the cliffs and the wildness there, and that was incredibly successful and something I really enjoyed. I think if you grow up on the coast like I did in Brighton, it's always a fascination and a draw, and there's lots of my work has had the sea. Obviously, my current show doesn't because it's based at Petworth, but yes, it's a massive inspiration.
Yeah, have you seen the landscapes changing? Obviously, Burning Gap's changed quite a bit.
It dropped off into the sea.
You actually see that, those
changes?
Well,
I went there quite a few times to do my paintings of Burlin Gap, and they have this cordoned-off area. Yeah. And it's quite terrifying because it's not really that marked. It's just a little ribbon line, and the cliff is literally dropping off. So, yeah, I did see that. And they have that little area where you walk out on top of the steps where you can see the cliff in the distance. and you can see it crumbling in the distance if you go several days in a row. So it is quite a dangerous spot, but it's a beautiful spot.
Yeah. What about that wildlife, birds? Is that come into your painting as well?
I don't actually paint. So the thing with my work is I like to sort of lose all kind of detail. So I never ever paint from a photograph. I only ever paint from sketches I've done or paintings in the area, because for me it's about the sense of the place, a mood, an atmosphere, a moment. And I believe art should be accessible, and I hope that the viewer can connect to a mood or something that they've seen and relating to themselves, or something that a landscape they know. It doesn't necessarily have to be specific. So I won't necessarily have a bird or a man and his dog or something like that. It's not that figurative. It's much more just that essence, almost like a memory.
Yeah, yeah. I recently spoke to Faye Bridgewater, a local artist, and she has this hut at the end of her garden and went there during artists' open houses. So how do you kind of get the discipline to switch off everything and just get painting for that?
Yeah, well...
that must be quite...
You mean working from home?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I've done both things in the past. I've had a studio not at home, and now I do have a studio at home. For me, the problem with having a studio not at home was actually getting myself there. So having a studio at home is much more accessible for me. And I just kind of, I switch my mobile phone off. I don't take my phone into the studio with me. And because I am an early bird and I get up really early and I'm in there by 7, I don't really give myself a choice to get into the day. I think if I got into the day, I'd be distracted. And that's kind of why I do the early morning stint. Everyone goes, oh, you're so great being up early. But I kind of think, if I went in around 11, I'd never get in there. So I kind of have that pattern for myself. And then I know the afternoons, you know, late afternoons are free. And I really, really enjoy it. I mean, it's a bit tricky in the winter because of the light. I live in an old Victorian house, and my studio was a billiard room on the end of the house. So it's got some lovely windows. But obviously, when you're painting at 7 o'clock in the morning in the window, the light's a bit tricky. So I've invested in daylight bulbs, which are fantastic. And I just go in and lose myself.
Yeah, brilliant. Do you find yourself painting... Do you paint what you think people might want to buy then, or how does that work?
Well, because paint for a buyer, you mean? Oh, that's a tricky... it's a difficult... I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
It's difficult. I mean, you know... I think at the end of the day, when you're an artist, you must always paint for yourself. You have to do you and paint what authentically you want to convey. For me, it's that joy in nature and that mood of nature that I'm seeing at that moment. If people like it, they like it. If they don't, they don't. I'm very fortunate that over time it's been successful. But I think if people weren't buying it, I'd still be loving to paint what I paint. I don't think you can paint for a market, because then you won't be able to consistently keep it up. To keep painting consistently and a lot of work and a body of work, you really have to actually be true to yourself, and then you're actually painting what you want to paint. Because if you're turning yourself into something for other people, you won't actually keep it going. That's my view anyway. Yeah. I might be wrong. It might work for other people.
When do you know when a painting's finished?
Mark!
That does fascinate me, because there's always
yeah.
something else you can add to a painting. It's like an essay, isn't it?
There's
always something you can add
yeah.
to it. When do you know?
Well...
Do you get a feeling, or...?
I will say this. I think I've got better at it over the years, but I am a perfectionist, and my paintings get layered. So oil paint dries very slowly. It's not a quick medium. So I'll paint one level, then I'll paint another. And in between, they go, I've got like a shelves on my wall in my studio, and they go up on the drying wall. So I kind of live with them about. They kind of live with me for a while. And so it might be a week before I put another layer on the painting. And then there's that moment. Do I stop? Do I not? And I think I know when I'm there. I think now... I tell myself, if I'm like with this with the brush and I'm starting to fiddle around a bit and it's all kind of a bit unnecessary and it's getting a bit finickety, step back, put it down.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you can overdo it and it gets overdone, and then you've ruined hours and hours of work.
Yeah.
To pull it back round from an overstep painting is almost impossible.
Have you got paintings that you haven't put out there that you're not happy with?
Mark, the bin is full of them. Because you have to be a bit ruthless about it. You have to judge yourself as well and get better at it. And it is hard for an artist because, or anyone really who does anything in the creative industries, you're close to it, aren't you? It's sort of come from you in a way. So obviously everything's wonderful, but it's not. Not everything is wonderful. And you really have to step back and appraise it properly.
Yeah, it must get a bit annoying if you think a painting's not going quite how you want it to, but then you've already invested all that time in it and you just you just want to keep going just so you can complete it?
I think I paint in both oil and watercolour. And watercolour, I think, is trickier because you never really master watercolour. Watercolour kind of masters you. Because it's such a fluid medium and it's moving around the paper, I buy really thick paper and I put loads of water and paint on. Yeah. And so you have to go with it. So it kind of tells you when it's finished. You're not in control. Whereas with oil, you're much more in control of able to move it around the canvas. Yeah. It's difficult. What can I say?
All right, brilliant. I'm going to leave it there for the first half. We're going to speak a lot more to Lucy in the second half. So join us then. Back here with Lucy Marks, the painter, and we're going to talk about the exhibition at Petworth House. Great location, isn't it?
It's an absolutely beautiful location. Yeah. If people haven't been to Petworth House, I certainly urge them to go. There's not only the gorgeous amount of art that you can see there. Petworth was known as an art house, you know, from the time it was built, really. It's got Turners and it's got William Blake's and it's got Gainsborough's there and the whole wing. But it's got a 700-acre deer park and then some gorgeous formal gardens. So you can take a picnic and go into the house and sit and see the deer and sit and look at the beautiful gardens, and it's just a fantastic day out.
Yeah, and so what's the exhibition about then? Is it a permanent exhibition that
Dusk
Till Dawn?
So my exhibition is called Dawn Till Dusk. The other way around.
Yeah.
And the idea is it's the cycle of the day in Petworth Park and Gardens.
Yeah.
It's on until the 19th of September, so it's on all over the summer. And I was invited by Petworth House and Gardens to actually paint their park and gardens for the show. So the idea of the show was that I actually work painting the landscape and reflect Petworth. So they actually charged me with that. They'd seen my work from some of my other shows and they'd invited me to do that because I'm a landscape painter. I'm very lucky it's on to the 19th of September. It's a long time. But it was just a joy to paint. So I've been out there for several months now. So how I work is I go out into the landscape, as we talked about before.
Yeah.
I have a little wooden easel that I take out with me. And I was out there in January and February in the rain. I had my little mittens on and my little crackers that you put in your hands to warm them up. You know, those hand warmers.
Yeah.
And I was standing there. I've got thermals, I've got waterproofs. And I'd be out there for about 4 or 5 hours on a painting day in the park. And it was majestic. I mean, I didn't realise until I started painting it was 700 acres. Because I think if they'd told me that, I might have thought twice. Because I've learnt to walk across the whole park and get my art stuff down to a little rucksack.
I told you you've got to cover
every little cranny you've got to paint. And you know, they've got the wild deer as well.
Yeah.
And the deer, I've never really seen deer up close and personal before, but they're huge and they're very majestic and they're very curious as well. I think because I'm standing still painting for so long, they do pop along and have a little look from a distance, check out if I've got any food. But yes, I've painted the park. They gave me a key to the gate so I could go in out of hours, because my idea was to do from dawn until dusk and catch, you know, the big skies over Petworth at both closing and opening time of day. So, it was just fantastic.
Yeah. Once again, I mean, how do people access the exhibition? When does it start? When does it finish?
So it's actually opened. It opened on Saturday.
Yeah.
And all you need is a ticket to the house to get in. I would recommend that you book online at weekends for your ticket. My exhibition is free once you've got a ticket to the house.
Yeah.
But if you book online at weekend, because it gets very busy. And we are in COVID times. That probably will change as we go forward. But in the week time, I think you're probably pretty much okay. Get a ticket to the house, go in, you can see all of Petworth House as well. You can see the Turners, and then you can go and see my work.
Yeah. So what sticks out for you then when you were kind of painting? That did you have a set number of paintings that you needed to exhibit?
I mean, well, that's a really good question. It was actually tricky because obviously they invited me in lockdown. And so they sent me a little map of the gallery. And what I did was I kind of worked out what paintings I would do where. So there's some really large kind of showstoppers in the show that are 2 metres by 1.5 metres. And then the ones I did out in the landscape with my pochard are obviously smaller, and they're like 20 by 30 centimetres. So it's kind of got a good range. But what I did was I worked out the sizes of different paintings and what walls they might go on, and kind of gave myself a little plan. So I painted to a plan. 68 paintings.
Yeah, brilliant. And I mean, this is kind of, this exhibition is going on. Have you got, what else have you got planned in the future in terms of?
Well, while this is on, I'm going to be painting over the summer and doing a little thing, because I've been invited in the autumn to do I've been invited to have be an invited artist at ING Discerning Eye. So that's very, very exciting. And so I've got to paint for that. And then when this exhibition comes down, I'm going to start my next exhibition, which was what I was just starting to do before I was invited by Petworth Park, which is Constable used to live in Brighton when he, you know, the old famous painter. When his wife was very sick, she had tuberculosis, he lived in Brighton, and he used to do 3 walks out of Brighton and paint along them. So I'm going to do those walks and to paint along them in my own takes of those walks. They still exist, they've changed a lot, and that's what I'll be doing as of September when this one closes.
Yeah, has lockdown inspired you at all, or not inspired you? I mean, what?
Well, I mean, I think it's been tough on everyone, hasn't it? I mean, perhaps less tough for me because I do work on my own a lot in my studio. Artists tend to be it's a bit of a solitary thing.
That's what I said to Faye Bridgewater when I interviewed her, that you kind of use, it's a solitary
You're kind of used to it, it's a bit solitary. But by the same token, you know, you couldn't actually go out. So in a way, it kind of inspired me to go into my paintings more. But I do know some artists that it kind of thwarted them. But I was lucky that didn't happen to me.
Yeah. Do you ever get quite a painter's block where you kind of just don't fill up?
You know what? I haven't yet. Yeah. I haven't yet. I'm so lucky. I never feel I have that problem. But I think that's because the topic that I'm painting is always a landscape, and it's forever changing. You know, you can go out to the same hillside 10 times and the sky will have changed, the trees will have changed. So you never get bored. So I never get bored with what I'm painting. So perhaps that's the trick.
Yeah, what do you hope for in the future? Do you just want to be recognised? I mean, do painters want to be recognised as a great? It's often once they've passed that they get seen as a, you know, like Lowry. I'm thinking Lowry in particular.
Yeah.
But sometimes people don't recognise today's art as being of national significance until
they've died.
On. Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, the art world's a big world, and I think that as an artist, for me, what I hold to is I actually love to paint.
Yeah.
So whether my painting gets more and more successful or whether it doesn't, I try and stay grounded, and I will always paint because I love it. Of course, I would like it to be recognised. You know, everybody wants their art to be recognised in many ways, but I don't paint for that. I paint for myself, and I paint for because I love it. And I also paint because I get challenged by it. So, you know, painting in oil, it's a very difficult medium to paint in. It takes a long time to learn how to paint in it, and I feel I haven't learned enough yet. So it's always a challenge as well. And I know some, you know, I have an amazing art community with me as well online, and, you know, that I've grown to know over the years. So for me, that's what counts. And I think if you go into anything for fame and fortune, you might be bitterly disappointed. So you have to kind of stick to what's right for you.
Yeah. What about portraits? Have you ever painted portraits?
Well, funnily enough, actually, when I did my MA at Brighton in fine art, my degree show was portraiture, but I moved into landscape afterwards. So I might, who knows, I might take to them again. You never know. But at the moment, I'm very happy with my landscapes.
Yeah. Brighton Skies, it's quite a famous, popular Facebook page where people, it's photography rather than painting, but people are getting really into art a lot more, aren't they? And particularly kind of, as I say, you know, skies and landscapes seem to be quite popular. So more people are taking up painting.
I think you're really right there. And I think that's come out of lockdown.
Yeah.
I think everybody has sort of, in a way, we were forced to rediscover the nature on our doorstep because we had nothing else to do.
Yeah.
So it was a way of coping. And I think people have really fallen in love with nature again and the meaning of it and the value of it. Whereas before it might have been, oh, that's beautiful. But now I think people are really appreciating it in a different way.
Do you think when people look at paintings, because when I go to like the big galleries in London, you should get from it what you want to, not what you think people should... think that what you should be thinking. You see what I mean?
Yeah, when I see painting, all that history that comes with it.
Yeah.
Well, I think art should be accessible. And I think that I think art should be for everyone and everyone should be able to see a painting and not feel endowed with the history that comes with it. I think they should just see the joy in it. And we should teach kids in schools and adults that, you know, in a way lose the stuffiness and just absolutely enjoy what's in front of us. It's great to have the history about these paintings. We're very lucky as a country. We've got huge big hitters like Turner and Gainsborough and Constable, but also not to be hampered by it, you know, absolutely relish in it and just see what's in front of you and love it or not love it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And just before we finish up as well, after this open houses, it's quite an interesting way of making art more accessible. I think it's been pretty successful in Brighton, hasn't it? It's brought artwork to the the masses.
Well, I think that art is for all, and I think everyone who makes and creates should share in that. And I think it's great that all the artists have become really successful. Brighton's had very successful open houses, and long may it continue. You know, it's great that they're getting the footfall through the doors, and it's got a name now. You know, it's an absolute thing on the calendar that people love to see.
Exactly. Yeah. And once again, it's Petworth House, isn't it? The exhibition, and people just buy a ticket for it, and it's going to be there along with. With the Turners.
Well, along with the Turners, to the 19th of September.
Brilliant. Okay, and so that's Lucy Marks. Thanks for coming today.
Thank you.
All
Thank
the best
you,
in the future,
Mark.
Lucy.
Thank
Take
you.
Care. Thanks.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.